Hi, good morning, and thank you for joining us. I'm Whitney Clavin. I'm a science writer and media specialist with Caltech's Office of Strategic Communications. It's my pleasure to welcome you to Conversations on Sustainability. This series is hosted by the Caltech Science Exchange, which has a great website full of factoids and science explanations on a range of topics. As part of this sustainability webinar series, we're hearing from scientists and engineers working on cutting-edge research that can help mitigate global warming. I am joined today by J.T. Reager, an earth scientist at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, or JPL, which is managed by Caltech for NASA, and Indrani Graczyk, program manager of the NASA Western Water Application Office at JPL. We're here today to talk about water resource management and how JPL and NASA satellites help in this endeavor. J.T. and Indrani, thanks for being here. So to start off, we just want to hear a little bit more about your cool jobs. So let's start off with JT. Tell us about what you do.
Sure. So I am a scientist in the Terrestrial Water and Ecosystems Group at Jet Propulsion Lab in the Earth Sciences section. So as you know, we do many things at JPL. We put satellites into space that look outward to do astronomy and look for things like exoplanets. We put rovers on other planets like Mars to do planetary science. And then we send assets up to orbit to take observations of the Earth, to measure how it's changing in time. And I tell people, you know, we're kind of like doctors for the planet. And just like a doctor might listen to your heart with a stethoscope or look in your ear with that funny lit up magnifying glass thing, we have these different instruments up in space and they're all giving us information on vital signs of the planet Earth. And then we all have our specialties within that. So for me, my specialty is water. I study water and how it cycles around the planet. Water, you know, as we believe at NASA, when we're looking for life on other planets, the first thing we look for is water, because we understand water to be the basis of all life as we know. So that's what we do.
And as a little side note, I hear you have a connection to the book Dune, which we want to hear about, since Dune is a very dry planet and relevant, and the movie just came out.
Yeah, so this movie's out. It's of course based on a series of novels by a writer named Frank Herbert. And I originally, I think, read one of these books as a teenager and then again in my 20s. And I think I was in a spot in my life. I had graduated with an undergraduate degree in aerospace engineering. And I was like living at home and not doing anything and not knowing what I wanted to do next. And I read this book and I became fascinated by this idea of terraforming, or, you know, a planet as a machine that can be changed with water. And this, you know, water being the oil for that machine, I guess, and solar energy being the gasoline for that machine. And this interaction between water and energy really, really driving the face of a planet and how planets look and how they can support life. So very inspirational for me. And I have not seen the film yet. I'm very excited to do that. A little nervous to see it, but I'll see it probably really soon. So, yeah. Thanks.
I thought it was really good myself. Yeah. And I read the book. But okay, let's move on and hear a little bit from Indrani about your job.
Hi, I'm Indrani Graczyk, and I'm here as the manager of NASA's Western Water Applications Office. So that's a NASA program that was established about 5 years ago to really connect with water managers and to encourage the use of NASA data to help in water management. So before the office was established, there was already a number of scientists out there who had made good connections with water managers, who had proven that measurements taken from satellites, or measurements actually taken from even airplanes, could give them information that really helped them with their work, especially as water management has gotten more challenging in the West. So we put this office in place. We do a lot of work. We talk to water managers. We try to understand their needs for tools, their needs for information. And then we come back to scientists like JT and take the work that they're doing and try to help them apply that work to solve those particular needs. So it's been a really great experience working in this office and working on something that really benefits, takes what we're doing for NASA and for space and benefiting life here on Earth.
Very cool. Okay, so now let's start going into talking about the drought. Like, we're hearing in the news things are really bad. So can one of you give us an update on the status of the drought in California? I think maybe JT, we're going to start with that, or Indrani. Indrani, why don't you start with that?
Sure, I can give you the basics. Yes, California is in drought, and we've been hearing about that for a number of years. Right now, the government maintains a site called drought.gov, and it uses a variety of information and even satellite information to determine what areas of the country are in drought. In California, I looked at it just this morning, about there's five levels of drought, and about 80% of California is in those top two worst levels. So the reality is we've had two pretty dry years in a row, and that has led to these conditions, parched soils, not a lot of snow up in the mountains to melt and run into our streams. And so the other thing that people will hear a lot about is reservoir levels are at some really scary lows right now. Lake Mead got to the point where it was so low that the states that had historically been able to take water from the Colorado River had to reduce their allocations. And that's a pretty big deal. That has not happened in the history of the Colorado Compact. And then our largest reservoirs are also at some pretty low levels. Oroville and Shasta, I think, are all below 30%. So yeah, it is a pretty, as far as droughts go, this one is historic, I would say.
And I remember you telling me before about how it's really down to these extreme storms that determine if we're in a drought one year or another, and that I guess we didn't have enough extreme storms this year.
Well, so the water year, water managers think of a water year going from October 1st to October 1st. So those past two, the 2020 to 2021, and I think the 2019 to 2020, were pretty dry years on record. JT could correct me, but I think that they're in the bottom five of recorded dry years. And so now we've started another water year on October 1st. And I think most people remember we had a pretty good storm in the month of October. We need a number of those storms to get back to anything that would be considered normal. And that is part of the issue, the challenge that I think our water managers face, is that I think people who lived here 20, 30 years ago would remember that the months between November and February were just wet in general. Mm-hmm. And now those months are pretty dry, except for maybe three or four storms. And the difference between having three storms versus having five storms is a difference between being in severe drought versus being completely out of drought. So we're getting our water from a lot of these extreme events. And it's really hard to predict in that situation whether we are going to get enough water to get out of drought or not. So this water year has just started. I think I've read that people are predicting that it's not going to be a wet year, but it's really hard to tell at this point whether or not we're going to have a good year water-wise or not.
Okay, and then how does this chunk of time in the last 2 years compare historically to drought levels? And how has global warming affected this?
Yeah, JT, do you want to take that?
Yeah, so this is a great question. Just building on what Indrani said, you know, I think most places on the planet, they get on average, you know, about 50% of their precipitation on the 13 wettest days of the year. And in California, we get about 50% of our precipitation in the wettest 4 or 5 days of the water year, as Indrani said. So we live in a dry place in California, especially Southern California. And it's really peaky in years where we don't have a lot of those big storms. It really makes a difference in our water supply. And we're not only seeing this drought being very intense, as Indrani explained, but really a sequence of increasing dryness, consistently, secularly increasing dryness over the past 20 years or so. And so there's some wonderful research. A researcher named Park Williams out of UCLA has done a series of papers now showing that the past 20 years, starting in 2000, 2001, up until the present, are probably the driest 20 years that we've had in the past since the year 1200. So, you know, almost the past, you know, 800 or so years. And they're calling this last 20 year period a mega drought, that it was, it's really getting wet and really getting dry. And we just don't know how that's going to shape up, but it certainly takes a toll on our water resources. And as we have, you know, increasing demand and increasing population and increasing agricultural needs, you know, a change in supply is something that's really important. Indrani mentioned the Colorado River Compact. I forget what year this was. I think it was 1937, when the waters of the Colorado River Basin were divided among seven states in the Southwest. You know, ironically, this was one of the wettest 20-year periods in the past 800 years or so. So we thought we had a lot of water. We built a lot around it in the Southwest. And now we're moving into a drier epoch, and it's just, it's gonna take a toll all around, I think.
Okay, not great. But let's back up and understand more about the water cycle. So JT, why don't you start telling us a little bit about that? You know, how do we get water on our planet? And then also specifically, you already touched a little bit on this, but how does the water get to LA?
Sure. So on our planet, we have a finite amount of water. We don't lose water to space. So it's all contained, and all water at some point starts and ends in the ocean. So it evaporates, moves through the atmosphere, and precipitates over land as either liquid precipitation or snow in most cases. That's that water flows down mountains, through river systems, recharging groundwater and soil moisture, and then eventually either evaporates again or runs back into the ocean, completing this cycle, so to speak, that we traditionally know as the global water cycle. In California, snow for us is very important. We have snow that hits the Sierra Nevadas in our rainy season in the winter, and then the gradual melt of that snow through the summer. So peak snow is typically regarded as April 1st in the year. And then that snow melt, which runs into the Central Valley for agriculture and also for residential use, usually melts through the summer, through into the fall. And what we're seeing with climate change is we have less precipitation falling as snow, and then it's melting earlier, so shifting the snow season. And so snow is like our battery. It's how we store water through the summer. And with climate change, we're really seeing the size of that battery capacity diminishing. So that's something that's happening.
Okay, so then the question is, how do people manage this whole process? How do we make sure the farmers get enough water and that we get our drinking water? And this is for Johnny.
I'll take that. I don't know if I can do a good job describing it, because it truly is extraordinarily complex in the West. There are thousands of agencies involved in getting water to your tap. I think here in California, the most important thing to realize is that it's a combination of federal agencies, state agencies, and then local municipalities and regional water districts. Average homeowner deals with a utility, but really the two organizations that are kind of responsible for water in the state are the California Department of Water Resources and also the California State Water Control Board. So, you know, the way water works in general, and this is probably mostly relevant to agriculture and utilities, is when you think about it, what happened in California in 1949, you had lots of gold miners coming out here and using water to mine for gold. And there were many, many little rivers and streams, and they would build these wooden canals to divert the water to be able to use in their mines. And so the person with the land right by the stream didn't necessarily get the water because somebody above might've been using it. So we developed a system here called first in time, first in right, such that if you started using the water, then eventually it became enshrined that you had a right to that water, and it was associated with the land that you own. So our system has a senior water rights and then junior water rights, depending on when you made your claim for your water. And so in times when we have a lot of water, everybody gets the water that they have a right to. In times when there's less water, the folks that have the oldest water rights are the ones that will get the water, and then the people who have younger water rights will get less. And so this whole system is administered by the California State Water Control Board. And then there's also the California Department of Water Resources that tries to ensure that our water resources and our water infrastructure is maintained and is of sufficient quality. But so there's what I'm trying to say is there's multiple organizations and a very complex structure to determine who gets how much water and how it gets to them and the water quality standards. And it's just really, as somebody who came into this 5 years ago, I'm still amazed that it all works so well. But people do cooperate, people do they take their job very seriously. And there are people talking across the federal, state, and local levels to just ensure that everything is working, so that by and large, in this time, there are places that are genuinely running out of water, towns where you genuinely have to truck water in for the residents. But by and large, people are working together really well across all of these layers to get water to everybody who needs it.
It's just making me think of Dune again and the Dune planet, and they need water management on that planet. It's not going very well there. But okay, so let me know. Next question, yes, is about NASA and JPL. How are the satellites helping with this process? How are they helping in water management? JT, you want to start with that one?
So yeah, thanks, Whitney. So you know what we do, as I explained, in earth sciences, is we're putting stuff up in space to be able to better observe what's happening around the planet. We also do suborbital activities such as aircraft flights or in situ campaigns to help support what we're seeing from space with on the ground information or airborne information. And we have a lot of satellites that are up there now. We're kind of in a golden age, so to speak, of water information for this planet, where we have more information streaming in now from satellites than we've probably ever had at any point in human history. So really the challenge is just making sense of that data. And I typically like to think of a kind of three-tiered system where, we kind of have data, which is just the raw information. And then above that is information, actually. And then above that is understanding. And so to take data and actually, which is just, numbers or, reflectance or gravity or, radar, something like this, some number, and to convert that into information, that's primarily the task of scientists. We wrap algorithms around data to convert it into a variable that we all recognize, like snow depth or like soil moisture. And then, the next step is to take that information and wrap it into a contextual understanding of what's happening on the ground. And that's when it really brings understanding. So bridging that gap between data, information, and understanding is the task of the scientists. And we have more data now than we've probably ever had in the past.
And then do you have a specific example of a certain satellite that you could just tell us a little bit more and how its data would ultimately help?
Sure. Well, the satellite that I've worked on the most over my career, which is by far my favorite mission that JPL has ever launched, is called GRACE. It stands for Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment. And actually, right now we're on the GRACE follow-on mission, which was the second gravity mission that's launched. And these two missions are very interesting. They each consist of two satellites that orbit the Earth in tandem, one following the other. And as they pass different portions of the planet, they measure differences in the planet's gravitational pull, the gravity field of the planet, and map these out with GPS. So on about a monthly basis, scientists get these maps of how strong gravity is in different places and how that's changing in time. And really the only thing that's heavy enough and moves fast enough to cause major changes in the Earth's gravity field is water. And so with these satellites, these measurements of gravity changes can be proportionally converted into water storage changes. And with that, we can see things that we've never seen before from space or on the ground with the naked eye, which are like, you know, deep changes in groundwater, in aquifers, things that are otherwise hard to observe, or the amount of snowpack on a really big mountain range. And so being able to measure those changes, changes in the Amazon rainy season, how much water falls in the Amazon in a given year. You know, we really have this special insight into how the planet is changing and how the key processes that drive water around the planet are changing. So as I said, taking that data, turning it into a piece of information like snow or groundwater change, and then wrapping that into a contextual understanding of why that change is happening, what's driving it, is it purely natural? Is it also due to human activity and pumping like we see in California a lot of times? Placing that context around it is really the key task to bring understanding.
And then how, Indrani, does your organization use that data to help people?
So even before the Western Water Applications Office came into being, there were a number of instances where scientists like JT and others, the work that they were doing with satellite data and the information and the insights that they were being able to develop from looking at satellite data, they were reaching out to water managers and saying, you know, is this something that you can use? And there are a number of really nice partnerships that, especially with the California Department of Water Resources that had been developed between NASA and CADWR, to measure snow in the mountains and to make a forecast about how much water would melt into the reservoirs based on measuring the snow in the mountains. Or like JT was talking about with removing groundwater. When you remove groundwater, you have what we call land subsidence, right? And so that subsidence could have potential impacts to a lot of infrastructure, especially water infrastructure. So there were nice partnerships around trying to use satellite data or airborne data, as we call it, to measure things that are of importance, useful information for water managers. So what the Western Water Applications Office is just trying to build on that. We're trying to be more deliberate. So we reach out to these water managers. We talk to them about their needs and their challenges. We try to bring people together with similar needs and challenges and really kind of identify, hey, something we call a use case, but what would this data need to look like? What product do you need in order to help you with your decisions? And then we come back to the scientists and we say, okay, in the course of your science, you've been able to derive this kind of information from satellite data. Now, can we work together to put it into a form that is useful for water management? And that sometimes it seems really trivial, but it isn't always the case. Everybody's got their constraints in how they can use data and how they can use information. And there's certain freedoms when you're doing something for science versus when you're doing something for decision-making. And so it really is trying to take all the good science that's been done and make it useful for water management. A lot of what the Western Water Applications Office tries to do is taking the things that have been done for science and gearing them towards what we call applications. So we're fortunate, I think, that water managers certainly recognize that they have new challenges now. They can't, the old methods, which basically worked, they weren't perfect, but they basically worked, they need better tools now. And we're fortunate that they really wanna work with us and that we have some really good successes that we could show. There are new satellites coming on board, new radar satellites, new missions that NASA is undertaking that could potentially produce even better information for water managers. And so we try to educate them about what might be possible and then really develop solutions that are useful and that can just fit into the operations that they're already under. There are a lot of challenges to doing this. There's a lot of challenges to taking something that's worked well for science and translating into applications, but we have a really great community on both sides that we can work with, both within water management and within the science community. And when we get the right people in a room together, they can do some really wonderful things.
And do you have any specific examples of how this data has influenced like a certain group? And then as part of that question, I'm also wondering like how quickly this information is comes down to people. Like, if the groundwater changes today, then how soon do people know about it?
Well, it depends on the mission. And that is one of the things that we are working on. NASA's working on is how to make ground systems or the computers that process the satellite data, how to create products in a way that's timely for use in water management. So that is something that we're aware of and we're working on. So like I said, the U.S. Drought Monitor does currently use satellite data to determine if a area is in drought. Some of that data is from the mission that JT was talking about, but other missions that are figuring out what's the moisture of the soil or what is the moisture in the air. So there's a lot of different satellite products that are being used by the Drought Monitor. One interesting story I can tell you about is we had a scientist here at JPL that worked with the Department of Water Resources to develop a system called the Airborne Snow Observatory. So it's a plane that would fly over the Sierra Mountains, the specific basins that melt into the Hetch Hetchy Reservoir and some other reservoirs. And really by flying over those mountains when there was no snow and then taking a really what we call a LIDAR measurement, it's kind of like bouncing the light off of the ground and measuring how much time it takes to come back. So you get a really accurate measurement of the height of the ground. And then coming back when there's snow, doing that same measurement, and that difference is the snowpack. And so this mission was able to determine in some places to like 98% accuracy how much water was going to melt from that snowpack into the reservoirs. And so this was extraordinarily useful information, not only for knowing how much water you have to allocate for that year, but also for operating the hydroelectric dams. So if you know that you'll have enough water to start the dam, the hydroelectric part of the dam a little earlier, that's actually very valuable information to the hydroelectric power suppliers. And then also, if you remember a few years ago, we had a bit of a catastrophe at the Oroville dam, right? Because there was too much water in the Oroville Reservoir. So if you have a sense as to how much water is actually going to melt in the Oroville, you can do a controlled release of that water before it becomes a problem. And people don't want to do these releases, right? Because you don't want to give away the water and have it just spill out into the ocean. But if you know exactly how much water is going to melt into your reservoir, and to some extent, this mission was also able to tell when it was going to melt, which was really valuable information too. We're able to, you know, prevent disasters. We're able to make the best use of our water, and we're be able to, you know, supply our farms and our industries with the water that they need. So this is one example of something that was done. This was done with an airplane, but NASA is looking at missions to be able to measure snowpack from space as well. And so then that data will be available more widely. But yeah, there are just, and that predates my program, the Western Water Applications Office, but it's just an example of some of the ways where when we can get water managers with a need together with these scientists and their really innovative ideas that we can do things that just prove to be pretty valuable and everybody likes the result. So that mission, so that you know, we actually spun off a commercial company from that. And so now that's available as a commercial service.
Okay. And I heard that you have a riff off JPL's motto of dare mighty things, and that you guys in your business say dare practical things. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure, I'll try. So of course, NASA is known for, you know, extraordinary achievements, right? Putting the first man on the moon, the International Space Station. Here at JPL, what we work on are those really difficult first of a kind science missions. So I think JPL first cut its teeth in interplanetary exploration with the Voyager missions. And those are our first pictures of Neptune and Uranus. And those spacecraft that were built, I think 40 years ago now, more than that, are still operating today. They've left the solar system. They're exploring space. So our previous center director looked at this body of work, looked at everything from Voyager to Mars rovers and Mars helicopters, and the way JPL is able to do things that really no other organization in the world can do. It's just an extraordinary community and a group of people out there. And he said that, you know, the motto for JPL is dare mighty things. We dare those things. We dare to do those things, and we make it look easy, but we dare to do the things that really are hard that no one has done before. And so that's what we're known for. We're known for these first of a kind missions, these really difficult missions for NASA. But the folks that are trying to take this data, especially this earth science data, and put it to use to benefit life here on earth, what they're doing are practical things, right? But it's not easy. So that's why we have the motto of dare practical things, because sometimes it may seem trivial to take a satellite and observation from space of snow on a mountain and use that to figure out how much snow is there. But it is work. It requires innovation. It requires new algorithms, new ways of thinking about data, new ways of putting data together, data from satellites with data on the ground. There's a lot of innovation. There's a lot of really great minds trying to make good use of our Earth observation data. And so, yes, we are daring practical things. And I really do appreciate all the great work that scientists like JT are doing to make that happen.
Cool. Okay. Thank you. So we've hit 11:30 and we're going to move on to the Q&A portion. And we've already got some questions lined up here. The first one is, how do you measure drought and wet or dry years all the way back to the year 1200?
Yeah. So, you know, we have different ways of measuring drought, right? So drought is a bit of a funny word because some place that's very dry, like the Sahara Desert, for instance, doesn't really have a drought. So the concept of drought is always a conflict between supply and demand. It does mean that there needs to be demand or need for water, and that supply is not available. Once we kind of set up a baseline for what's a normal wet year and what's a normal dry year in the present, just in terms of how much rain is falling, which we observe with rain gauges and radar measurements, to how much snowpack we have in the Sierra, to how much soil moisture there is. All these are different indicators of droughts and types of drought, how much water flows in rivers. And looking historically, we have to be really creative because there's obviously no satellites before, the 70s or so as Earth observing satellites. So how do we measure drought back to the year 1200? So this is done with tree ring measurements. So trees tend to grow more when they have more water, and trees tend to grow seasonally. And of course, everyone's heard the axiom that if you count the number of rings in a tree, you can know how many years old that tree is, as long as that tree is in a place with a seasonal climate. And so literally counting tree rings is how scientists determine the historical wet and dry periods in a place like California. And looking at those tree rings, we can see wet years, wet decades, wet centuries, and even relatively wet millennia. And those tree rings usually go back to about 1200 or 1000 years, depending on the availability of those trees. And aging those trees, dating those trees, and putting those rings in temporal context.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, Do you have any thoughts or ideas about how this drought will affect our next fire season? Or maybe that's not your area. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, no. So I've actually done some drought and fire work. So, you know, typically we think that when it's drier, we're going to have worse fires. That in drought years, we tend to have bigger fire years. And in places that are well forested, that's usually the case. Places like Southern California specifically, we have a different type of ecosystem here, right? We have this kind of chaparral and grassland dry ecosystem, and we've had that for centuries and millennia, actually. What tends to happen here is that fundamentally, there's two things that really control fire occurrence. One is the availability of fuel availability, and the other is fuel moisture, or how wet or dry that fuel is. For bigger fires, you want a lot of fuel that's very dry. It can catch quickly and it can burn profusely. So in Southern California, what happens is when we have a wet year or a series of wet years, we get a big green up where a lot of new grasses will grow in grassland, and the chaparral will kind of sprout and spread, and these kind of shrubs will really do well. If those wet years that create a lot of fuel are then followed by dry years that actually dry that fuel out, this sequence of wet during the rainy season and then a very dry season are the years that actually correspond to the biggest fires in terms of burned area and fire catastrophes. So that's specifically for Southern California and places with big forests where there's already plenty of fuel. It's usually just a function of dryness. But here in Southern California, it's actually wet years that lead to the biggest fire years after. So anti-logic there, but that's how it works.
So then where are we at now in terms of the next fire season?
Yes, so we are in fire season. So, you know, fire season nominally starts in September, October, and goes until, actually can even start earlier, like July, and then goes until, we get our rains for the year, which sometimes are in November, sometimes December, or sometimes later. So until it's wet again, we're at risk for fire. I think we've already had a couple of fires this year. I haven't monitored specifically, but we did have a period of wetness after 2016, and now we're in this new period of dryness the past 2 years or so, and this being one of the driest years on record. So we're definitely prone. And just a personal anecdote: I was out taking a jog in my neighborhood in Sierra Madre here in September, and I saw this troop of 20 guys in black sweats running around, and I said, "Hey, who are you guys? What are you doing?" And they said that they're forest fire fighters for the National Forest Service, and that they expected a big fire season this year, so they're doing extra training, and this was part of a 20-mile run that they were committing to.
Wow.
So I think people think it's coming. It remains to be seen if it manifests, but the risk is definitely there.
Okay. All right, this next question is for Indrani. Do you face challenges in translating the space-based scientific data to policymakers and non-scientists?
The short answer is yes. I think scientists are looking at the information in a different way versus what the information that water managers need to, or water managers can base their decisions on. I think NASA produces lots and lots of data. There are NASA missions that are going to go up that talk about downloading terabytes of data every day, right? Or petabytes of data every day. And so a scientist, especially our scientists that are working in this climate change earth science realm, are used to being able to work with these massive amounts of data. What water managers need are generally, single numbers. I need to know how much flow is in this particular stream. So one of the issues is sometimes NASA comes to water managers with just this exquisite large data set, and filled with analyses around probabilities or around sort of scientific analyses and simulations. And what the water manager really needs is just that one number. Can you get me that one number and can you get it to me when I need it? So water managers, you know, they have IT constraints as well that sometimes you won't find in a university or you won't find at NASA. And so there is a lot of thought within the Western Water Applications Office and within the NASA Applied Sciences Program of, you know, how do we build our data systems so that they're producing the right kinds of data, producing the data that basically takes something that perhaps is already being used and just enhances it with the satellite data, right? So you get just a better number than you would have otherwise, but still trying to produce the data in a way that is easy to use for water managers. It just naturally slides into those systems. And one thing about, you know, water management in the West, which I maybe didn't talk too much about before, is the federal government does play a significant role, especially when it comes to providing the data. We talked about the drought.gov site and the US Drought Monitor, but there is a lot of data that the states get from the federal government. And so when we work with the agencies that are really involved in water management, which include the Bureau of Reclamation or the US Department of Agriculture, there are systems that they have in place where they're already providing data in a way that it's easy to use. And so NASA, we talk a lot to those agencies and those offices as well and say, well, how do we get this great work that's being done into your systems? And so it's not, there are always challenges. They're always a little bit different, but that is the work that we're trying to do. We're trying to get this NASA data set, make it easy to use for water management. And that sounds like it ought to be trivial, but sometimes it's not.
Okay, now we've got another science question. This one be for JT. Is the world getting wetter on average due to global warming, which would mean more evaporation and more water in the air? So why is California getting drier with climate change?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So, you know, there's a classic relationship between the temperature of air and its capacity to hold water vapor. So it's the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. And it says for about it's every half degree of warming, the water holding capacity of the atmosphere increases by like 7% or something like this. Maybe that's for every degree of warming. So we would expect that as the atmosphere gets warmer with global warming and the surface gets warmer to heat the atmosphere, that the atmosphere could hold more water vapor. But what we really find is that doesn't necessarily lead to precipitation. And that regionally, there's really different things that drive the delivery of moisture from the ocean to the land. So for instance, you know, we get these atmospheric rivers in California, which are these big events that just pump a ton of water over the state of California, over the Sierra Nevada, and cause it to rain here. And those events can be really disturbed by some kind of atmospheric ridge formation, which is where we just get this kind of high pressure system that sits right near the edge of the state and kind of blocks that atmospheric river from coming in. So the dynamics of the planet are very complex. In general, climate scientists use this motto that kind of the rich get richer mechanism, which is that we expect with climate change that wet places will get wetter and dry places will get drier. And that just means that generally around the tropics and the very high latitudes where it's already pretty wet, it's going to probably be more convection and more convective rollover and wetter conditions. And then in the mid latitudes where typically the world's deserts are located, it's more dry, that we will get less lateral transport of this moisture from equatorial northward, and things like the jet stream will change position, and that dry places will generally get drier. So the rich get richer mechanism is what's expected for water and precipitation with climate change.
Okay, we have time for one more question, and we just want a quick answer for this. What future JPL missions are you most looking forward to? Both of you. but quick, because we got to end at 11:45.
we have this great mission that's going up. It's actually a collaboration with the Indian Space Research Organization called NISAR. And there's a lot of good applications that are going to come out of it's a twin radar, and there's just a lot of good applications that are going to come out of that for water management. So I am looking forward to that one going up.
JT?
Yeah, so exciting question. I mean, what part of what we do is play a role in figuring out what missions we need to have next out of space, and that is happening at all times at JPL. Right now, I'm excited about future gravity missions. So something called mass change at this point, we don't have a specific name for it, but doing some studies now about what that might look like and if it'll be similar to the existing gravity satellites we have, or if we could have a different architecture.
Okay. All right, well, we're gonna wrap things up. So thank you everybody for joining, and thanks to our speakers. The next event in the Conversations on Sustainability series is coming up on December 8th, when my colleague Lori De Jose will talk to Caltech's Victoria Orphan and Diane Newman about how microbes on land and the ocean play a role in the climate. That sounds really good. In the meantime, if you're interested in learning more about science solutions for a warming planet, please check out the Caltech Science Exchange. The site provides clear, factual answers on critical topics in science and technology, such as vaccines, earthquakes, and even now our new section on quantum physics, which is really fun and has a lot of mind-bending facts for you to look through. All of that is at scienceexchange.caltech.edu. Thanks for joining.